Good morning, friends. Welcome to worship. My name's Alex. I'm the pastor here at PPAC Reformed Church, where our mission is to be a congregation called by God, empowered by the Holy Spirit, and committed to being the very presence of Jesus Christ in the world. That's who we are, and that's what drives all that we do. Well, I hope you found our digital bulletin. This will be our guide throughout the morning. If you've not yet found it, there's a link to it in the description of this video. Well, welcome to worship. As you can tell, I am not at church. I'm not in the sanctuary. The power is out at church. The power is actually out here, but it's a little bit lighter in here in our dining room than it is in the sanctuary at church. So I thought I would record here from the dining room. Well, it's been yet another challenging few days. The past year has brought a global pandemic, a cultural revolution, and now a tropical storm. If you're feeling like I am, you may be in a place where you feel overwhelmed. You may be in a place where you feel frustrated. You may be in a place where you feel deeply, deeply unsettled. Life feels so unpredictable. And yet, even in the midst of the unpredictability that life throws at us, we can rest in the reality that God never changes. That God is the same yesterday, today, and will be the same tomorrow. So friends, welcome to worship. And ultimately, it is this God who never changes, who welcomes us into worship. Join me in the call to worship. Children of God, come to the waters. We gather to be restored and renewed. Come with your faith and your doubt. We respond to the one who claims us and calls us. Come. Christ summons us to draw near. Let us worship God with joy and thanksgiving. Friends, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
friends, let us now confess our sins to God. Please join me in praying the prayer of confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts, minds, and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been, amend what we are, and direct what we will be, so that we might delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, friends, the good news of the gospel is that the story does not end with our sin. So hear this good news from the book of Romans and in chapter 8. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. And Christ is interceding for us. Friends, in Jesus Christ and by his blood, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Well, as God's forgiven people, we are called then to live into God's design for human life. So hear these words for how we are to live as God's representatives in the world from the book of Philippians. Do all things without murmuring and arguing, so that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, in which you shine like stars in the world. Let's now sing the Gloria Patri together in one voice. Friends, may the peace of Christ be with you. Share a sign of peace with those you are physically gathered with and those you are virtually gathered with via the comments section.
It is time now, it is time now.
friends, please now join me in the prayer for illumination. God in heaven, send your Spirit so that we might see Jesus, and in your grace, come to know him more deeply and follow him faithfully. Amen. Left Jacob limping away from the clay banks of the Jabbok River. He wrestled with God all night and came away a changed man. Quite literally, God renamed Jacob, meaning the deceiver, the heel grabber, Israel, the one who strives or wrestles with God. Now God has told Jacob to go back home, so Jacob must now continue his journey back home to Canaan. But in order to get home, he has to pass through the southern land of Seir, where his brother Esau lives. Now, if you recall, Jacob has been pretty nasty to his older oafish brother. He has stolen his birthright for a bowl of soup, and he has stolen Esau's final blessing from their father, Isaac. Now, as Jacob was racing away from home after he had stolen Esau's blessing, Esau was shrieking angry death threats at Jacob. And on the banks of the Jabbok River, Jacob's messengers told him that Esau was coming after their caravan with 400 of his strongest men. It looks like Jacob is on a crash course with karma. Will Esau be looking for retributive justice? Has Jacob's wrestling match with God truly transformed his heart? Or is Jacob's deceptive scheming simply in his DNA? Will there be peace? Will there be war? Or will there be something else altogether? Friends, hear the word of the Lord from the book that we love. Now Jacob looked up and saw Esau coming and 400 men with him. So he divided the children among Leah and Rachel and the two maids. He put the maids with their children in the front, then Leah and her children, and Rachel and Joseph last of all. He himself went ahead of them, bowing himself to the ground 7 times until he came near his brother. But Esau ran to meet him and embraced him and fell on his neck and kissed him, and they wept. When Esau looked up and saw the women and children, he said, "Who are these with you?" Jacob said, "The children whom God has graciously given your servant." Then the maids drew near, and they and their children bowed down. Likewise, Leah and her children drew near and bowed down. And finally, Joseph and Rachel drew near and bowed down. Esau said, "What do you mean by all this company that I met?" Jacob answered, "To find favor with you, my lord." But Esau said, "I have enough, brother. Keep what you have for yourself." Jacob said, "No, please. If I find favor with you, then accept my present from my hand. For truly to see your face is like seeing the face of God, since you have received me with favor. Please accept my gift that is brought to you. And because God has dealt graciously with me, and because I have everything I want." So he urged him, and Esau took it. And then Esau said, "Let us journey on our way, and I will go alongside you." But Jacob said to him, "My lord knows that my children are frail, and that the flocks and herds which are nursing are a care for me. And if they are overdriven for one day, all the flocks will die. Let my lord pass ahead of his servant, and I will lead on slowly according to the pace of the cattle that are before me and according to the pace of the children, until I come to my lord at Seir." So Esau said, "Let me leave with you some of my people who are with me." But Jacob said, "Why should my lord be so kind to me?" So Esau returned that day to Seir. But Jacob journeyed to Sukkoth and built himself a house there and made booths for his cattle. Therefore, the place is called Sukkoth. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, at first glance, this looks like a happy ending to a bitter rivalry. Some Bible commentators have even called this story a prototype of forgiveness and reconciliation. At first glance, it has all the ingredients of a Hallmark movie resolution. There's the initial uncertainty of what the encounter will be like. There's the great scene of the brothers seeing each other after being apart for 20 years. I imagine each of them climbing up opposing ends of a hill or a mountain, panting for breath, and then seeing each other's faces as they both reach the crest of the hill. There's the Philadelphia, the great scene of brotherly love, as Esau, the one who was wronged, not Jacob turned Israel, runs toward his brother, who has wounded him severely on two occasions with tears trickling down his cheeks. There's the embrace, the beautiful embrace. Brother and brother, arm in arm at the top of the peak. Esau's 400 strongest soldiers looking on through their iron-barred war helmets. And Jacob's maids, servants, wives, and children looking on in their hiking garb. Each party as surprised as the other at what they're witnessing. There's the moving display of overwhelming emotion and abundant affection. Tears flowing ceaselessly from each brother's red eyes, their bodies heaped together in a bear hug and heaving rhythmically with each storming sob. They hug, they kiss, and they can't stop weeping. It's been 20 years, after all. 20 years of resentment, bitterness, uncertainty, 20 years of guilt, shame, and grief, 20 years. And the 20 years of pent-up tension releases in a puddle of tears. Upon first glance, all the Hallmark movie makeup scene ingredients are there. The pre-existing tension, the uncertainty, the initial encounter, the embrace, the emotionalism, it's all there. Ready for us to wrap a bow on this encounter and label this encounter a model for forgiveness and reconciliation. Now, call me a skeptic. Call me a Debbie Downer. Call me whatever you want to call me. But I have a really hard time calling this encounter between Jacob and Esau a reconciliatory encounter or an episode of forgiveness. Let me tell you why. And in order for me to tell you why, we have to take a closer look at the rest of the story, at the rest of the dialogue. While the picture of Esau and Jacob hugging and weeping and kissing each other is a beautiful one, what follows after the dialogue may clue us in on the true relational status of the brothers, and further may help us understand what the true nature of forgiveness and reconciliation looks like. Well, after the heart-swelling, tear-invoking episode between Jacob and Esau, Jacob re-offers Esau his grand gift, his animal arrangement of sheep and goats and cattle and lamb and rams, and Esau refuses. But then Jacob says this curious line, "No, please, if I find favor with you, then accept my present from my hand. For truly, to see your face is like seeing the face of God, since you have received me with such favor. Please accept my gift that is brought to you, because God has dealt graciously with me, and because I have everything I want." At face level, Jacob's intentions seem kind, gracious, and genuine. He really wants his wronged brother to accept his generous gift, to make up for the hurt that he has caused him. That's what it seems like. But let's keep reading. After Esau finally accepts Jacob's grand gift, Esau seems to think that in accepting his brother's gift, something will shift in their relationship, or something has shifted in their relationship. So he asks Jacob if he and his men can accompany them on their way home. And what does Jacob say? Well, he basically says, "The pace of our caravan is much too slow for your liking." Jacob says directly, "My Lord knows that the children are frail, and the flocks and herds which are nursing are a care for me. And if they are overdriven for one day, all the flocks will die. Let my Lord pass ahead of me." But Esau won't let Jacob's refusal of his company deter him from their newfound brotherly love. So he gives Jacob another offer in verse 15. "Let me leave you with some of the people who are with me," Esau says. Here, Esau seems to be looking out for his brother's safety. Traveling cross-country with only women, children, and animals was asking for danger. Surely Jacob could benefit from a few of Esau's Arnold Schwarzenegger-built soldiers to ward off any bandits. But again, Jacob refuses. "Why should my Lord be so kind to me?" he says. And the two part ways. Now, has anything really changed in Jacob and Esau's relationship? I mean, really, has anything changed? Sure, they share a beautiful embrace and a powerful exchange of affection and a mutual showing of emotion, but has the character of their relationship changed or shifted or become something other than it was? To me, Jacob and Esau part ways doing the same dance they've been doing for the last 20 years, the dance of avoidance. They do that same familiar dance all the way until they meet again to bury their father, who held on much longer than each of them thought he would. Though at first glance Jacob and Esau's encounter was sentimental and emotional and moving, their dialogue with one another reveals a relationship that has not truly changed. The gifts Jacob offered to his betrayed brother was merely a band-aid on a gushing relational wound of betrayal and deception. While Esau seems to be willing to try something new, Jacob feels as though his gifts have appeased his brother's anger, and he will continue to dance around him instead of embracing a new future for their relationship. About forgiveness and reconciliation, Archbishop Desmond Tutu writes, "Forgiving and being reconciled to our enemies or our loved ones is not about pretending that things are other than they are. It's not about patting one another on the back and turning a blind eye to the wrong. True reconciliation exposes the awfulness, the abuse, the hurt, the truth. It is a risky undertaking, but in the end it is worthwhile, because in the end, only an honest confrontation with reality can bring about healing. Superficial reconciliation can only bring about superficial healing." Jacob never confesses his wrongdoing. Jacob never repents of his wrongdoing. Esau never holds Jacob accountable for the hurt that he has caused. Though their sentimental and emotional initial encounter has Hallmark written all over it, just because someone cries when they have wronged you doesn't mean that they are truly sorry. Tears do not equal turning from wrongdoing. We cannot equate displays of emotion as evidence of true forgiveness or reconciliation. Likewise, when you embrace someone who has hurt you, but they have not acknowledged how they have hurt you, you are not truly reconciled to that person, because they could just keep repeating what they've been doing and continue to show affection as a band-aid over the relational wound. Reconciliation and forgiveness are difficult, messy processes. And they are processes that Jacob and Esau have sidestepped. And instead, they are doing exactly what they were doing before their encounter, avoiding each other. Breaking familiar ways of relating is difficult work. It's difficult work that requires intentionality, bravery, authenticity, vulnerability, empathy, and courage from both the wounded and the wounder. Dr. Everett Worthington Jr., a professor of psychology at Virginia Commonwealth University, wrote a wonderfully applicable book called Moving Forward. And in this book, he outlines the 5 steps to forgiveness and reconciliation. Worthington states that these 5 steps can be easily remembered by the acronym REACH. So first is R. R means recall the hurt. As painful as it was, we have to call it to mind. We have to feel the hurt in our body. We have to remember what it was like, how it felt, what was said. That which is not recalled cannot be healed. Recall the hurt. R. Second is E. We have to emotionally replace unforgiveness with empathy towards the one who hurt us. Why might the person have taken the actions that they did? What was going on in their heart and in their mind to cause them to act the way they did? Even though I may not agree with their action or liked their action that they took toward me, can I understand it? E. Emotionally replace unforgiveness with empathy. And then third is A. We have to find somewhere deep within ourselves the altruistic gift of forgiveness. A altruistic gift of forgiveness. As Christians, we love because God first loved us. Our forgiveness is not fueled by our own will, but by the power of the divine within us. We draw on the deep reservoir of grace that we have in Jesus. And from that grace, we overflow with grace and forgiveness to others. In Jesus, we can give what is undeserved. In Jesus, we can forgive 70 times 7. In Jesus, we can become wounded healers ourselves. In Jesus, we can give the altruistic gift of forgiveness. A, altruistic gift of forgiveness. And then fourth, the fourth step is C. We have to commit ourselves to practicing forgiveness. By God's power at work within us, we commit ourselves to the forgiveness that we offer, and we refuse to backtrack to resentment and bitterness. C, commit to forgiveness. And then H, fifth, we have to hold on to forgiveness when we doubt that it was real and genuine, or when the person who hurt us hurts us again. We commit ourselves to being the kind of people Christ calls us to be when we hold on to forgiveness. We forgive and forgive and forgive. We feel the hurt, we acknowledge the pain, and we keep on loving anyway. In this kind of living, we mirror Jesus. The Apostle Paul writes, "Even while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." And again he writes, "Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. But Christ died for us, and Christ rose for us, and Christ reigns in power for us, and Christ intercedes for us." Deep relational wounds are so hard to mend. And sometimes toxic people in our life cause us so much pain that we have to step away and disengage from them. But for the relationships in your life that are not beyond repair and have been neglected and avoided because they have felt too messy, I encourage you to reach for forgiveness, to show up authentically, courageously, vulnerably, and intentionally, and to draw on the deep well of grace that you have in Christ so that you might be what Christ is for us, a wounded healer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Friends, let us now affirm our faith by saying the words of the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, at this time, I do invite you to give to the ministry of PPAC Reformed Church. In this season, your gifts are appreciated more than you know. Each gift is sacrificial in nature and makes a bigger impact than you will ever realize. If you want to give, if you feel convicted to give, if you feel called to give, you can give through two different ways. You can either give online at our online giving site in the description, and there's a link to that in the description of this video, or you can mail in a check donation to P.O. Box 253, Gladstone, New Jersey, 07934. Thank you so much for considering giving to us in this season. Well, let's now pray together a prayer of the people. Let's pray. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we come to you today frustrated, overwhelmed, confused, disappointed. We come to you with circumstances that feel yet again overwhelming and unpredictable. And yet, Lord, we come also hopeful. As Christians, we know that pain and frustration and difficulty will never have the last word. But ultimately, the last word will be written by you, the author of all life. And in you, all things are still being made new. So we trust in you. We believe in you. And Lord, we ask that you would enter into our situations as vast and different as they are, and that you would meet us just as we are and take us to the place where we need to be. God, we lift up our country to you. We lift up our state to you. 1.4 million people without power. God, we lift up those who are most vulnerable, those who are most deeply affected by the latest tropical storm, who are food insecure, who are homeless. God, we lift our hurting world, our hurting state, our hurting country up to you, because we trust that you are the one who is in control, and only you can redeem, restore, and make new. And God, we pray for those in our midst who need your loving care and tender presence. We pray for Barbara David, for Walter Fogelsanger, Stacy Grady, Jan and Steve Miller, Carol and Ron Weiss, Morgan and Joe, Margaret and her family, Bobby, Philip and Claire, Kathy and Pam, Mary, Kathy Johnson, David Jr., Chrissy, the Roberts family, and Robert and Dorothy W. All of this we pray in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, praying together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ. I invite you now to receive this benediction. I invite you to extend your arms and open your hands to receive this benediction. Wherever you go this week, go knowing that God loves you. And because God loves you so much, that love overflows into love of your neighbor and your friend and your sister and your brother and your aunts and your uncles and your grandma and your grandpa and your kids and even your enemy. The love of God overflows within us so that we can become who Jesus is, a wounded healer. So friends, as you go, may you go with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.